little dots here, is a very small version of a very shrunken version of an alignment between the opsin gene family. So each one of these is each row is the protein sequence of an opsin gene through four or five species, and then switches to the next opsin gene, four or five species. And so you can see that this is a very large gene group. There are many, many opsin genes. And if you look at, if you run your eye vertically, you can see that there are red lines, faint red lines running vertically. These are where there are differences between the sequences.
What is an opsin?
I'll get to that. And then where it's black, these are where there are similarities. So you can see that within this gene family, first of all, it's huge. And secondly, there are not that many differences between genes across individuals, between individual genes themselves and then across species. Very, very well conserved. So what opsins do is that they catch light and they turn it into an electrical signal. So they're essential for vision. And this is why they have hung around for so long. And this is why they have relatively the same sequence across animals and across genes. Because if you disrupt the sequence too much, the gene can, or the protein encoded by the gene, can no longer pick up light. You really need to retain the basic structure of the protein in order for it to pick up light. The most primitive opsins developed very early in the Cambrian period. And their function was really not visual. It was to pick up light, but for circadian purposes. So an animal would be able to detect light and day. And this would then regulate all kinds of hormonal processes within the animal that would regulate its behavior, its feeding, and its reproduction. And so, of course, circadian rhythms are still around. We all have them. But they've become more complex, and they're not entirely dependent on light anymore. So all of us have an innate circadian clock in our brains, which sets a basic rhythm, and then that is affected by light. So you know that if you go overseas, if you go over to Europe, your circadian rhythm is messed up for a while, but you still have more or less 12 on, 12 off cycle. But as you're exposed to light, which is now going to be different by 7 hours, you eventually adapt to everyone else's circadian rhythm who is there. The next step up from the circadian opsins were the visual opsins. And with eyes came visual opsins. And it is really mind-blowing that the most complex forms of color vision evolved in the Cambrian period. And from then on, things didn't really get much more complex. They became a little more complex or a little more refined in some groups of animals. And they became a lot more degenerate in other groups of animals. And what determined that was lifestyle. So for example, if we look at the lungfish, the retina has three layers, three cellular layers. The outermost layer are photoreceptors. And the photoreceptors are the cells which contain opsins. Their job is to pick up light and transduce that into an electrical signal, which is then transferred to the other two layers and finally to the brain. So there are two types of photoreceptors, rods and cones. And in this diagram, you can see the cones are pictured as cones and the rods as rods. And the cones are really where all the action in terms of opsins and color vision are. So already in the lungfish, which is another living fossil, which is one of the earliest tetrapods. So the lungfish is similar to the coelacanth. When the coelacanth was discovered, around about the 1920s or 30s, a fisherman fished out this animal out of the Indian Ocean and noticed that it had four limbs, which seemed to move independently, even though it wasn't a fish. And the coelacanth was, they're still around, we think. We don't know for sure, but we think they're still around in the Indian Ocean. They're another of these living fossils that tell us what some of the early tetrapods could have looked like. But already at this stage, animals had this really highly developed color vision, where they had four different color pigments in their cones. So they had two blue pigments. One was shifted to pick up the violet spectrum. The other shifted to pick up the blue spectrum. They had a green pigment, and then they had a red pigment. And in addition to that, in their rods, they had rhodopsin. So the rhodopsin system has stayed unchanged. It has absolutely stayed unchanged over evolution. Everybody has rods. Everybody needs to see to some extent at night. Everybody has rhodopsin. But it's in the cone system where radical differences have occurred. And this is dependent on lifestyle. So, for example, with birds and some of the diurnal reptiles, in other words, reptiles that make their living by day, color vision and cones have become incredibly refined and very elaborate. The same four pigments are still present, but for example, in the case of the birds, they have, in addition to these pigments, they have oil droplets, which act as bandpass filters. So if...
They have what?
Oil droplets within the photoreceptors that act as bandpass filters. So let me explain a little bit to you how these opsins work. The protein sequence of the opsin determines what frequency of light it can pick up. So some opsins, their protein sequence determines they can pick up blue light, and others can pick up green light, and others can pick up red light. So if you think of light, and the sensitivity of opsins to light, it looks like a bell curve. And in the middle of the bell curve is where the opsin is most sensitive to that frequency of light. So for example, red opsin is about 570 nanometers. It'll pick up light at 570 nanometers. And then as light is either a shorter frequency or longer frequency than that, you get out to the ends of the bell curve, which means that the opsin doesn't respond to them as sensitively, but it doesn't not respond to them either. So if you imagine, the light that we see is in all of these frequencies. And our red opsins are picking up frequencies most sensitively within the 570 nanometer range, and less sensitively either before or after that. And with the combination of opsins that we have, as well as the processing that occurs in the retina and the brain, we can see an enormous number of permutations of frequencies that recombine to give us the color spectrum that we have, that we now know. So birds really have evolved this to the best degree of all animals, particularly predatory birds like eagles, hawks, and so on. If we get to the situation of the mammals, this is the little diagram in the middle. It's absolutely pathetic. We've lost a huge amount of color vision. And I'll talk about the primates later, because the primates have gotten some of it back, but only very recently. So what's happened with the mammals is that we have lost one of the blue opsins, so we can only see light in the blue range, whereas some of the more primitive animals can see light in the violet range as well as the ultraviolet range. For example, actually some invertebrates can see it in the ultraviolet range, and some fish too. We've totally lost the green opsin in cones, and we have retained the red opsin. And we've also lost things called double cones. So if you look at the lungfish and the birds, there are things called double cones. So these are morphologically a cone attached to another cone. And we've lost some of those. And that's really a reflection of degeneracy within our cone system. And you may ask, why has our cone system degenerated? A cone system, animals that have a good cone system are animals that function during the day. We function during the day, but we didn't always. And the last part of the talk will be about how this came about. If we look at the platypus is also dichromatic. So you have dichromatic, trichromatic animals, tetrachromatic animals, even pentachromatic animals. The lungfish and birds are at the very least tetrachromatic, four different pigments, and combined permutations of those four different pigments to give them a colorful view of the world that we can't even imagine. But most mammals are dichromatic. They just have blue and red. The platypus is also dichromatic, but the interesting thing about the platypus is that its blue gene, the one it kept, is the one that the mammals lost. So you see there are two blue genes in the lungfish, and the ones that the mammals kept was shortwave sensitive one. Doesn't really matter what the name is. The one that the platypus kept is shortwave sensitive two. And it's linked to the red opsin. which is an arrangement.